Buenasera, buenas noches, buon soiree, guten Abend, and good evening. Did I forget anybody? That's about the limit of my linguistics, sorry. I appreciate the very kind introduction, and I would like to thank Dr. Chris Love and the TASIS Board for extending the invitation, for my European agent, Mademoiselle Patty Ducharme, for setting all this up. And for all of you and your TASIS colleagues who have extended such a gracious welcome to myself and my son. Now, I think he's had a magnificent time here. In fact, this afternoon he said, you know, if we moved here, I wouldn't mind going to school at TASIS. So it's been a wonderful trip, and thank you. I know you're all tired because you were skiing and you have a lot to do, so I promise no long speeches tonight. Cicero gave long speeches, and I think he lost his head because of it, so I'll try not to talk too long. What I want to talk to you about tonight, though, and hopefully help you out with a bit, are crossroads. And I don't mean the physical type. A dictionary will tell you a crossroad is where roads meet and continue on, maybe in the same direction, maybe not. I'm talking more of the metaphysical type, the figurative type, that all of you are a few months away from facing, because you're about to leave here and go on to something else. Again, in my spirit of being brief, I won't speak too long to you. Fighter pilots are renowned for being fairly brief and to the point, unless we're talking about flying or sometimes ourselves. That said, about fighter pilots, maybe we could play the first one. That I've learned, and maybe a few things I can pass along to help you with dealing with these crossroads. And the first of them is choices, having options in life. I never intended to do that. I went to school the first time to be an architect. Some of you, I apologize, are hearing this story for about the third time. But I never intended to be a fighter pilot. I thought that designing buildings and walking around in places that had come out of my head would probably be about the neatest, most satisfying thing that I can do. And I never intended to do this. As it turns out, I had a choice, and that's what I want to talk to you about. Everything changed for me about halfway through college the first time, and I decided to become a fighter pilot. We can talk about why later if you wish. All right, I've never regretted it, and again, it gave me a lot of choices in life that I otherwise probably wouldn't have had. In my mind, there's two ways to increase your options in life, and the first is something that you're already doing right now, and that's education. I know you probably don't feel like that, all right, but education, even just being here and finishing here, is going to open all kinds of doors to you that most people don't have and you probably wouldn't otherwise have. By the very nature of finishing this place, you're probably going to get into any top tier university you wish, and that also is going to increase your options in life. A famous American author named Edwin Markham once said that choices are the hinges of destiny. And I didn't really get that when I was 18 or 20, but I get it now. It just means that the more choices you have, the more options you have when life throws curveballs at you, which it will. Everything will change. And people facing change usually fall into three categories. There's people that always have a plan, right? They're kind of annoying because that was never me. And then there's people that don't have a plan. And then there's everybody else that's sort of in the middle that, you know, we kind of know what we're doing, but perhaps not. Right? And that's what having choices will permit you to do. You'll be able to be flexible. You'll be able to do what you wish in life and live life as you choose it instead of having other people make decisions for you. Right? The second part of creating options for yourself, I think, is what I would call mental flexibility. So that means even if you have a plan, if you think you know what you want to do, you have to be prepared for that curve that life's going to throw at you and be able to flex and move around into something else. And that's where your education and your options are really going to help you, because now you're not stuck with one answer to a problem. You've got maybe two or three. Here's an example, a personal example. When I finished flying fighters, and you can in fact get tired of doing that, believe it or not, I wanted to sail around the world in a big sailboat. I'd grown up on the ocean. I'd been a sailor all my life. I'd been in the Middle East for much of my adult life and was tired of the dust and the heat and the sand, and I'd been dreaming about water for a long time. And so I wanted to buy a big sailboat and go around the world, grow a ponytail, wear shorts, anything but a uniform. And so that's what I did. Nice big 60-foot sailboat. Life threw a curve at me. I'd gotten married in the meantime and had a one-year-old daughter. And I didn't figure out in advance that no matter how big the boat is, it's not big enough with an unhappy baby and a seasick, unhappy wife. So my trip around the world got sort of cut short and ended up in the Caribbean. I'm at a crossroads. What do I do? Well, I have choices. I could go back and fly for the airlines, like most of my friends did, which is about as exciting as driving a bus to me. Or I could go to work for a big defense company or something like that. But I didn't. I drug that old, nearly forgotten architecture degree out of the back of my head to the front of my head, and I became a commercial developer. Yacht clubs, shopping centers, grocery stores, that sort of thing. Other shops and things in the Caribbean. And it worked really well. And I thought, aha, I've gone through the crossroads. I'm on the road that I should be on. Everything's good. And a friendly word of advice, whenever you think that way in life, you should kind of look over your shoulder because something's probably on its way to hit you. And in fact, it did. Anybody over 25 in this room probably remembers the recession from a decade or so ago. And that effectively tanked the commercial development business. And now I'm at another crossroads. What do I do? Well, I can't fly for the airlines now because they're not hiring anybody. I can't work for the big companies because they're not either. Like I said at the beginning, choices. I still have some choices. Fortunately for me, I had a very specific set of skills from the military that certain private companies wanted to have. And they snapped me up. I had a family to support. I just couldn't go live on the beach and let my ponytail grow. So I went to work for a private military company. But again, I had choices. And I'm thinking to myself, this isn't something I wanted to do. This isn't something I ever thought I'd go back to doing. But I had to do it. But another great thing about having options is you don't have to stick with something you don't like. And you don't want to do that. Benjamin Franklin once said, most people die at 25, they just don't get buried till they're 75. And what he meant by that was a lot of people are just going through life doing something they don't really want to do. Well, I didn't really want to keep doing that, but I knew that if I kept at it and used my experience in education and the options that I had, I could change it. And it did change, not in any way I saw coming. Again, life throwing a curveball at you. I had gotten wounded coming out of Baghdad once, and I started to write down a little bit about my life for my young son who was on his way to being born. He's up there somewhere. Because I wanted him to know a little bit about me in case I disappeared, right? I had no idea that me writing that down would turn into a book. I had a friend who was a literary agent, and he said, hey, this is great stuff. How about if I see if I can sell it? I was indifferent. I said, yeah, sure, go ahead. And the next thing I know, HarperCollins in New York wants to buy the book. I had come to another crossroads, and I didn't know it. But because I had choices, I was able to get through the crossroads, and now that road I was on widened out into all sorts of things I never saw coming. They said the magic words, what other stories do you have? And now, all of a sudden, I'm an author. I never would have seen that coming. If somebody had told me that when I was your age or even 10 years earlier, I probably would have laughed at them. But again, it was an option, it was a choice, it was a skill, it was something that I could do, and it worked out well. Options create options for you. Remember that. The greater number of skills that you have in life, and the more that you can do, the more choices that you'll have. All right? And so those books then turned into television stuff. I was on the news for quite a while, for a few years, talking about whatever they wanted. I got calls from, the left coast, Hollywood, California, to do documentaries. I ended up doing some documentaries, which were very interesting. Some of them were nice, some of them not so nice, like ending out in the South Pacific finding Amelia Earhart, which was a grisly business, but I'll answer those questions later if you want. Some of them were quite interesting. For example, let's play number two there. You end up doing fun stuff like this for good Swiss companies.
Who's on my team?
We are Brightland.
We are great.
Cool, huh? That was me in the flight suit, in case you didn't get that. Anyway, the point with that is choices make choices. They beget choices. I had never would have pictured being able to do something like that or being part of anything like that. But I was, and it worked out well. Okay. The second suggestion or tool that I would pass along to you is something I call the mirror check. Okay, the mirror check. If at the end of every day you can look at yourself in the mirror, just you, no crowds, no cameras, no lights, and you can look at yourself and you can say, today I did it right. Today I was a good person. Then you've passed the mirror check. Okay? File it away under things you did good. They tend to get smaller and smaller as you get older. Things that worked. And go get a good night's sleep. If you didn't, and this is the most important point, and this is basic to flying fighters, we always try to find the root cause of anything that goes wrong. Not the end result, not all the symptoms, but what was it at the very beginning, at the start of all of this, whatever it is, that made this go wrong, or that I did wrong? And then you're honest enough to look at yourself in the mirror and say, all right, how do I fix it? How do I fix it? And how do I go on from there? Okay? The mirror check. A very famous French philosopher, author, poet named Albert Camus said that life is the sum of our choices. Alright? And it's fairly profound if you think about that. Life is the sum of our choices. I'm not telling you to be afraid of anything. I'm just telling you to try to remember that as you go through life. And if you can pass the mirror check, then that will help considerably. All right? The third thing that I would pass along to you is something I learned a little bit later. I wish I'd learned it sooner. And that is to try to earn the life that you've been given. Okay? To try to earn it. I should have been, this isn't hyperbole or exaggeration, I should have been dead so many times. I don't know why, to be honest. I didn't know why for a long time, why I would be standing here in front of another crowd, because I shouldn't be. I have my own ideas about that, and one of them is a little 12-year-old boy sitting up there. I think I had to survive so he could be here, because he's going to be, I don't know, president of Switzerland someday. That'd be nice. But the idea is that you earn the right to be here. You're not just going through life stealing oxygen and resources. Now, I'm not saying go out and join the military, or go out and join Medicine Sans Frontières or the Peace Corps. You can if you want to. That's fine. But the point is to do something, to give something back. And that may be no more complicated than just being a good citizen of whatever country you happen to be from. All right? But earn it, okay? Earn it. Every day is a gift. I try to tell myself that. Sometimes I forget it. I get busy and get caught up in things, and I forget that every day is a gift. But I try to remind myself of that. Okay? And it's an important idea. I know you're all worried about other things right now, and this is sort of, you know, at a different level. But try to remember that. All right? Every day is a gift, and try to do something to earn the right to be here. All right. So, I would tell you some takeaways. Again, options in life. Create your own options. Pass the mirror check when you can. Earn your life. Make it worthwhile. You do not want to look back someday and say, what did I do with my life, and not have an answer. Okay? In the end, you live with yourself the longest, all right? Try to do so with as few regrets as possible. And when you do that, I think that all of you can go as far in life as you want, dream big dreams, and fly as high in life as you want. Let's do the third. So, I told you the takeaways, my suggestions. It's worked for me and lots of other people like me, and I hope it'll work for you. And one more thing to say, and that's that this world we live in right now, the world all around us, is going to very shortly belong to you, okay? It's your turn. You're up to bat, so to speak. And I have every confidence that you and others like you will be able to change it and make it a better world. So go do it. Thank you.
We have time here for a few questions. So raise your hand if you have a question. Make yourself loud.
Yes. This is a little bit standard, but I always like to ask this to people who've traveled around the world. Is there a specific place you have in mind that you really enjoyed living in?
Like, well, I'd love to live in Switzerland. I enjoyed Germany very much. I enjoyed Spain. I don't think I would choose to live anywhere in the Middle East on purpose. Not that there's not some beautiful places there. I think if I had to choose somewhere other than Switzerland to live in, it would be Ireland. Anybody been to Ireland?
No.
Yeah, beautiful place. I mean, rain aside, it rains all the time. I thought the 40 shades of green thing was a cliche, but it's really not. I had no idea there were so many different shades of green. You could only see that in Ireland when the sun comes out. Why, what's your favorite place?
I'm gonna have to go and sit.
Besides Lugano? Yeah. Okay. Oh, why wouldn't you say Lugano? Right.
But I did enjoy Vietnam.
What's that?
I did enjoy Vietnam.
Oh, Vietnam, you didn't?
Oh, I did.
Oh, you did. I've never been there. I was never really a Far Eastern guy. I got stuck in Europe and the Middle East. Not that those are bad things, but I was never really in the Far East much.
What were the differences between the expectations you had before going to the front and when you were actually there?
Oh, between, what was it? I said this before, T.S. Eliot's, between the dream and the reality, there's the shadow. Yeah, there's definitely a shadow. I would say that, like most people, I had a glamorized viewpoint of war and combat. And I have to admit that as a young man, I thought that was a huge challenge, and you know, the little bit of macho that was left in me. I thought, if I can do this, I can do anything. I came to realize after that fairly quickly, when it wasn't training anymore, when it was real, that none of that is really true. Wars are horrible, awful, destructive things. And the videos are nice, but that isn't war. That's flying jets in peacetime. Actual war is nothing like that. It ruins lives, it tears apart countries. And I would say to all of you, because as I said, you're up next with all of this, if when you get to the positions of authority that I have no doubt some of you are going to hold, if you can solve your problems and those around you without war, find a way to do it. Sometimes they have to be fought. I can think of a few instances in history. All the ones I fought in could have been avoided. Okay? So if that answers your question, that's the biggest profound impact that it had on me. It was changing what you hear about, what you see in Hollywood movies or whatever, between the reality. And I wouldn't wish the reality on anyone.
Talking about Hollywood movies, did you have a code, like a code name or anything like that?
Yes.
What was it?
You want me to tell you?
Yeah.
Oh. I was called Two Dogs, and no, I won't tell you how I got the name. Real call signs aren't Maverick and Iceman and all that stuff. Real call signs are given out usually because of something stupid that you did as a pilot and everybody saw and you can't deny and you can't get away from. Mine wasn't for doing anything stupid, it was for another reason, and no, I'm still not gonna tell you what it is or how I got it. Sorry, I can't see. Yeah.
What exactly inspires you to be a fighter pilot?
What inspired me to be a fighter pilot? You know, I've asked myself that many times over the years, because as I told you, I never intended to do it. I could see myself in a nice cloth tie in an office somewhere. I guess maybe that's what did it, because that seemed sort of boring to me, you know? Putting up beautiful structures and making people's lives better is a wonderful thing. But I wasn't that thoughtful when I was 20 years old, and I just saw the challenge and the adventure, you know, of being a fighter pilot. And by the time I got into it and managed to survive everything to get to be a fighter pilot, well, I had to stay for a few years. You have to stay for 10 years. And, you know, it just becomes habit after a while. I never forgot, though. And I was grateful for the opportunity later in life to get to use the architecture and to build things, you know, and create things for people. But I'd have to say that's probably what it was. the challenge. I got over that pretty quickly, though.
How do you mentally come to terms with some of the things that you might have done during some of the wars?
Some of the things that you've done.
Yeah.
That's another very good question. She said, how do you mentally come to terms with combat? There's an excellent quote, I think I told some of your colleagues, from a movie called The Four Feathers. And the British officer is saying, in the end, when the flags quit flying, and in the middle of a battle, you're not fighting for a government or for politics, you're fighting for the man on your left and the man on your right. And that's how I dealt with it. I didn't want to be there in most cases. I didn't have a choice. Politics aside, we don't, you know, in America, in the American military, we don't control the government. So when the government says, when diplomacy fails and we have to go do something, we have to go, whether we personally agree with it a lot, you know, or not. We, you know, we all have opinions, we all have feelings and thoughts, but in the end, you're sent to do what you have to do. And it actually becomes a little bit easier because in the very end, it's somebody trying to kill me. And if I don't stay alive, then, you know, what's the point? So it's purely, you know, instinctive fighting back. I will tell you that as far as my conscience goes, I have no regrets because we're very careful about how we fight. And we don't blow up cities, we don't kill children, we don't do any of that. And everybody that I fought had a weapon and was fighting back. Okay, and if I didn't get them, they would have gotten me. Somebody else would be talking to you tonight. So I think only people that have done something wrong have conscious bad memories, regrets about it. I mean, I regret the waste and the destruction, like I mentioned earlier. But as far as it coming down to me staying alive or not, I have no regrets for what I had to do. But that goes back to a point I made earlier. And it's your responsibility, your generation, to try to avoid some of the mistakes that you, in particular, have seen other generations ahead of you make. And if you can, in fact, avoid war, then do it. Can't see. Yeah.
Oh, if you would have the opportunity to have a word with Mr. Putin, what would you tell him?
What would I tell Vladimir Putin?
Yeah.
I would say, I think it's time for you to go retire and go off somewhere in the world where you have your secret hidden villa and your millions, and turn the leadership of Russia over to somebody else. That's what I would tell him. Would he do it? No, I don't think so. But at this point, that's what I would tell him. If I could talk to him a year ago, I would say you're making a large mistake. You are underestimating the response of what's going to happen. And it's not going to work out well for you or your neighboring countries. And surely there's another way to do this without going to war. I guess that's what I'd say.
But you also think that the Americans are a little bit too far behind the line now about what's happening now.
I think the Americans are a lot too far behind the lines. Unfortunately, America, and I love my country, but it's a very strange country, all right? And you never know what's going to happen. You brought up Russia, okay. So in 2014, when the Crimea occurred, the annexation of Crimea, the Americans did nothing. So I'm sure Mr. Putin thought, well, I can get away with it this time too. Right? He didn't count on the change and the response. I think that America now has an obligation to see it through. Right? If we would intervene in other places less worthy than this, then why not this? But I don't live in Washington and don't make those decisions. I would have handled it differently, that's all I can tell you.
If we have no other questions now, I want to once again thank Lieutenant Colonel Hampton.